I think it is 1:15, and I think we will start out of respect for people that were on time. Thank you guys very much for this great turnout. We're really, really excited, although now it's dark and I can't tell if you're still here. We are going to talk today about radical retail and about startups transforming retail. We want you guys to know we'd love you to tweet and talk about what you're seeing. The two hashtags for this particular event are radical startups and radical retail. So please feel free to join us in social media and especially in tweeting this. My name is Jeff Hoffman. I'll be hosting this today. We have some amazing entrepreneurs in the retail business here with us today that we're going to talk about. I do want to make a comment before I introduce them or let them introduce themselves. I spend all my time working with entrepreneurs and startups around the world. I'm not going to waste my time on my backup, but I was one of the companies that I was involved in was we launched a company called Priceline.com. That was one of our startups, which was a startup radically changing an industry. Today, Priceline is the world's largest seller of online travel in 200 different countries, and it's a $76 billion company, and it was started just like they're starting their companies today. It was a radical startup affecting an industry. So we're here to talk about how radical startups are going to affect the retail industry and some of the things that we're going to see. People, when they think of change, they think of the big companies and the leaders, but startups change industries, and that's what we hope you're all here to hear. The thing I wanted to point out, though, was I am personally impressed. We picked companies that were radical startups. We picked smart entrepreneurs and leaders who were addressing the next generation of retail, and it turned out they were all female. So I am particularly proud of the fact that the tide is turning, and when you pick people on merit, it turns out we got 5 female founders and CEOs, and I am proud of you guys, and I hope this trend continues. Let's get right into this now. And let's talk about, I'm gonna let each of them introduce themselves. It's a lot better when I give these talks and somebody's standing there introducing me. I always stand there thinking, look, I'm sitting right here. I could actually answer that. So instead of me introducing them, we're gonna start at this end with Veronika, and you can introduce yourself and a little bit about yourself and your company for the audience.
Thank you. So my name is Veronika. As you can hear by the way I pronounce my name and my handle, my Twitter handle, I'm Russian. So my background is actually has nothing to do with fashion or retail. It's consumer trends and kind of marketing and strategy for advertising agencies. So before starting this, I was really interested in the consumer trends that were shaping the industry and understanding the products that consumers were interested in as well. So Thursday Finest, we print your clothing. So we're using 3D knitting machines, one of which we actually have upstairs in the iLab section. We're printing your clothing that's made on demand in your specific styles, colors, and sizes.
So before I go to Marta, I'm going to repeat what she just told you. All 5 of these companies have technology displays. If you want to see how you get 3D printed clothes, please go to the iLab. It's on level 4, and they will all be there later today, correct? With their companies and with demos. Marta.
Cool. So hey, everyone. My name is Marta, and I'm the co-founder of Claire. And my background is in CPG. So I used to work for a Fortune 100 company called Mondelez, which releases products like Cadbury, Oreo, Trident. And I basically helped set up their strategic pricing department, which led new product introductions and set price points for products across our 165 markets. And through that process, I found that introducing a new product into market is very difficult. And so now I'm the co-founder of Claire, and Claire is a testing platform for product development. So we work with brands and retailers to help them digitally test their products before they release them. And we help them identify their best sellers, their worst performers, and very tangible recommendations as to how they can make their products better. And one quick correction to the Twitter handle, if you want to tweet at Claire, the account is Say Hi to Claire. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Karen?
Hi, I'm Karen Moon, co-founder and CEO of Trendalytics. My background has been in retail in various operating roles, strategy, and also as a retail investor at companies like Gap and Goldman Sachs. With Trendalytics, you know, I recruited a team, my co-founder and I recruited a team of enterprise software engineers, data scientists, and merchandisers across a lot of the top companies in the retail industry. And what we're doing is applying big data to the merchandising problem. We have taken a big data approach to bringing in consumer insights into the product development, line planning, assortment, and pricing optimization aspects of retail.
Thank you, Karen. Monica?
Hi, my name is Veronika Phromsavanh, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of MODABOX. It's an online personalized shopping service for women. We curate fully coordinated outfits and deliver it to our customer doorstep using our custom build algorithm. So my background is in retail. I've been in the retail industry for over 16 years from every level you can think of, and I identify that the traditional retail is very, very broken, so we wanted to solve that problem utilizing technology, and we'll talk more about it.
Thank you. Neha?
Hi, everyone. My name is Neha. I'm the founder and CEO of Obsess. My background is in product management and software engineering. I studied computer science at MIT. I was an engineer at Google for 5 years and then led product and engineering at a luxury e-commerce startup. And before founding Obsess, I was the head of digital product at Vogue, where I launched the Vogue.com site, Vogue Runway, and their two mobile apps. So Obsess is a virtual reality shopping platform for fashion. So we are building a software platform that will let brands and retailers create discovery-based VR shopping experiences that are beautiful, immersive, and interactive.
Thank you very much. So we have some of the startups are obviously here from the Fashion Lab, but our focus is generally on the application of transformative business models and disruptive ideas on the retail industry. By the way, that being said, we want to thank the New York Fashion Tech Lab that is incubating three of these companies here. And I want to remind you again, not only to tweet them from their Twitter handles if you like them, but to go up to the iLab later and see some of these companies. So I'm going to give you a little bit of background. By the way, we have a lot of people standing. So one thing that might enhance your experience is letting someone sit on your lap. Raise your hand if it's okay for someone to sit on your lap and you guys can go. I apologize that we didn't have enough room. There is more there is not. Okay. So this is what we're here to talk about, the store of the future. Here's what we want to tell you very quickly. I'm going to talk fast because you want to hear from them, not me. We're going to talk about how disruptive thinking is redefining retail. Again, our whole premise is don't just watch the big box market leaders in retail because startups pop up everywhere, right? If you think about it, it wasn't a transportation company that radically redesigned it when Uber came out. It was a startup that did it. It wasn't a lodging company that radically redefined lodging. It was another startup called Airbnb. Radical startups change industries. That's what we're here to talk about. We're going to talk about how our customers change and why it's so important for us in retail. It doesn't matter what you think. And by the way, I see so many retail companies that glance over at their competitors and say, we're doing fine, because they compare themselves to the competitors. That is a waste of time. The only thing you should look at is the consumer. Track your competitors, but react to the consumer, because they will buy from who they want to buy to. We'll talk about that. We're going to talk about new technologies, everything from augmented reality to virtual reality, a little bit about AI, big data, just the fact that new technologies wipe the landscape clean again every day. So that just absolutely amazes me. And we'll talk about that, and then we'll just talk about radical new business models. Who's got a new business model, and how are they going to approach retail in ways people haven't thought of before? The retail landscape of the future, I just want to say, I already pointed out the fact that new technology comes from everywhere, and I'm going to take a second on that before we get back to our panel. But there's all kinds of other new opportunities, things like big data and the way we use data and analytics and the decision-making process on mobile devices. None of us could have seen any of this coming. None of us would have predicted the massive percentage of things that we buy now on our phone. If I'd asked you a short few years ago, how are you going to shop, even online, would have been a big step, but mobile, none of us saw coming. In fact, I think it's pretty amazing that for all the things I use my device for, whether it's texting, emailing, buying things, shopping, GPSing, you know what annoys the crap out of me when somebody calls me? The one thing I don't like to use my phone for is phone anymore. None of us would have ever seen that coming. And then last, as I already mentioned, we're going to talk about the global impact and the disruptive power of startups and how important that is. I just want to say before we go to the panel, though, that every day you wake up, something came from somewhere that you weren't expecting and from a place you weren't looking. And that's the message we want to reinforce, and that's why we chose startups here, is that quit following only the big brands if you want to see the future of retail, because startups continue to disrupt. I just took this picture very, very quickly about the change in retail, because that's a convenience store. It's a little convenience store in Seoul, Korea, where I used to stop. I gave a speech there recently. I went to the convenience store to get a cold drink on the way back out, and the whole convenience store was gone. That is a 3D computerized screen. There's no store anymore. If you walk up with your phone, you can literally point it at an object, pick up the milk, spin it around to check the date, put it down, hit another button, it'll be at your house before you get home. That wasn't there. It was a store. The next time I went there, it turned into a 3D phone click screen. By the way, it's on the side of the subway in Seoul. So you can order dinner and you don't have to carry it. It'll be warm or cold when you get home. Every day you wake up, something changes. If I were to ask you guys to name some of the world's most innovative companies, you would tell me Apple or Google or Samsung or whatever. Not one of you probably would have said Corning. They make glass and glassware. You would be wrong. I recently visited Corning, and they're developing a whole wave of smart glass. Look at this version of window shopping. These people aren't even going in the store. When she points at a coat, the directional sensor says, oh, she's pointing at the white coat. A 3D image of it floats up in front of her. She can spin it in 360. And by the way, you know what's at the end of your finger when you touch glass? Your fingertip. You know what your fingertip does? Identify you. So you see what's below that? It went out to her social media. It found all of her friends who bought that coat, and it told her the rating. And that if she has scanned her body, it'll show her what it looks like on it. My point is, it's a glass company developing the future of it. I just visited a smart glass company in Silicon Valley recently, and the window watches to see what racks and what products people are spending time with. The window has its own IP address. The window tells you that display is bad, no one's looking at it. That product's hot, everybody spends 3 minutes playing with it and then putting it back on the shelf. Technology and change is going to come from places you never saw. I recently spoke at Microsoft's big conference, and they introduced, just as an example, they introduced a new technology called HoloLens. And I said, what's the future? Do you look at Microsoft as your competitor in retail? No, you should, because look at HoloLens shopping. Whether you're doing design or shopping for a motorcycle, HoloLens, for those of you who don't know, and again, I'm just giving an example, not selecting any one company or product, HoloLens has helped me, Obi-Wan Kenobi, you're my only hope. Except it's in full 3D, and the motorcycle you want to buy appears on your desk in a hologram. You can change colors, change tires, and you can hear it roar before you buy it. The world is changing fast from places we never saw coming. That's what we're here to discuss today. So let's go back to our panel. We'll start at this end. And what I want you to share with the audience is, what is your radical invention, innovation, a disruption, and what led you to build this? What is it you're creating? Why is it different? And why did you do it?
Sure. So I want to be clear. So we're a direct-to-consumer company that works with retailers to bring this experience in store. I know there's a lot of B2B companies, but we're actually selling to the consumers themselves. So our 3D knitting machine can manufacture your products in as little as under an hour. So the idea is that you can come into a store, get a body scan, have something that's perfectly made, tailored to you in your colors, in your height, in your fit preferences. And let's say you're here for a conference in New York. You could come in, get a body scan, and then you're going back to California. You can actually have it local inventory management. For us, we're taking that process from just in time to made just for you. So we carry no inventory, and everything is made on demand.
That is fantastic. You guys, when you think about 3D printing, we're totally at the tip of the iceberg, right? I was just amazed when I was over in Serbia, where a lot of people had lost limbs. So you guys have probably heard of this company, but lost limbs from the bombs and the mines and everything post-war. And there was a group of 20-somethings with a startup that creates prosthetic hands and legs for $50. It's the idea for innovation, especially using 3D printing, is just a wide open range. So it's really exciting what you're doing. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. So at Claire, we're really focused on enabling companies to be more customer-centric. So I'm sure you've heard around that companies are all trying to be more in tune with their consumers. It's being labeled the year of the customer. But that, in theory, sounds very easy, but in practice, it's really, really difficult. It's hard to understand what your customers actually want. And so we're helping brands and retailers by allowing customers to provide feedback on products before they're released. So basically involving customers in the actual product development process and doing it through a channel that feels really natural to them. So we deploy chats on platforms like Facebook Messenger that allow customers to engage with brands and retailers and provide feedback on products. And one of the really interesting things that we found is that what customers say they want and then what they actually end up buying is quite different. And so what we've developed on our back end are these machine learning algorithms that ingest tons of customer feedback, parse through that data, and then make very actionable recommendations. So we can tell brands what products are going to be their future best sellers, which ones are going to be their worst performers, and kind of how they can tailor the product to resonate more with their customer base.
So already we've seen two technologies that all of us should be tracking. One is 3D printing. and the ways that we can use it in retail that we haven't thought of yet. But the other, when you said machine learning, you know, a lot of people are talking about artificial intelligence. I was driving down the 101 in Silicon Valley. Every other sign now says artificial intelligence. Not one sign existed a couple years ago. But what is the meaning of that? It's smart machines that learn with you and start to identify what you like, what you don't like, what the trends are, what your customers like. The whole application of AI is another tip of the iceberg thing. I have an Alexa on my desk, and every day I ask her increasingly more absurd questions, and every day she can answer one more than she could yesterday. It's pretty eerie, because one day she's going to start asking me questions. Karen?
Yeah, so what's radical or different about what we do at Trendalytics? Well, there's kind of two components, which I'll be brief on. There's the technology component, and then also the actual human and process component. And it really is the marriage of the two that is going to be the future of where merchandising organizations go. So from the technology side, we're analyzing moments in the consumer's journey. So across like the billions of interactions, if you think about it, last year, $2.2 trillion in retail sales were influenced by digital interactions. What we do is we're looking across disparate sources. So influencer social media buzz, we track thousands of searches on Google, and also track around 19 million SKUs at any given moment on pricing optimization. So what we're doing is we're tying those pieces together to understand, you know, where can like predict what consumers want now, but even 6 months from now. So how can merchandising organizations better plan for the future and know whether they should double down or whether at the peak. So the whole idea is how do you maximize how much money you can make around consumer trends. Now the other component of it is although we have all these fancy algorithms and machine learning, the other element is workflow management. And so although you can have this really fancy tool that looks cool or is even really pretty and intuitive, there's an element of how you integrate this to your workflow. So I'm proud to say at Trendalytics, you know, we're still very early in our growth. New York Fashion Tech Lab has been a really great component of it, but already in 2 years, we're working with retailers and global manufacturers that generate over $100 billion in retail revenue. And one of the bigger innovations has been working with each of these large organizations and developing how they innovate within their product innovation. So we're almost like a partner with them in terms of how they're redefining their merchandising organization. So that's kind of the other side of the equation that I think is really fun about being a startup in this space today.
Well, that's fantastic. Thank you. And you mentioned social media. So again, now we're up to three things. 3D printing, machine learning and AI, and social media. Three new opportunities for everybody in retail to be the first people to figure out, how do I use this? Everybody's talking about how do you mine social media, right? Because the voice of the customer is flowing in real time, what they like, what they don't like, how they want to shop. The people who figure out how to mine that data properly are obviously going to win and make a really big impact. In fact, if you think about radical retail, just a quick side note, many, many years ago, I had the opportunity to spend a day with Sam Walton, and I was asking how Walmart went from nothing to big, and the first answer he gave me was, we were the first company to figure out that even though there was no data, if you looked at credit card receipts in real time and found out what people were buying, you could optimize inventory. He literally said, if everybody's buying Pampers and nobody's buying Huggies, I'm just going to stop selling Huggies, or I'm going to instantly put a coupon out to make that traffic move. He said, we were the first ones to recognize there was this stuff called data. It was real time, it was online, and you can use it. Who's going to be next, and what technology are they going to use for the next innovation? Monica?
So with MODABOX, what we're doing is we're online personalized shopping service, and we do utilize a lot of data to help our customer and our stylists and our brands make better decisions in terms of we understand the color preferences, the budget, the styles, and all this information we collect and we provide this to the stylist to make sure they curate the perfect item for that what they're looking for. So in the retail industry, we have overflow of inventory. That's one of the biggest problems we have is how we cut down inventory or how we stop producing items the customers don't want. So for us is to understand what customer want first and be able to provide that more narrow options for them.
So let's talk about that a little bit. I don't know what that pinging is. Obviously someone's in a submarine. Is that my guess? Whatever's making that sound. Real-time inventory and real-time inventory management and control and just-in-time delivery. Those are concepts that we're still not great at, that are still huge opportunities to especially to optimize, obviously, inventory and cash for doing that. So that's yet another exciting area to look into is how do retailers optimize inventory, the right product at the right time in the right place. After all these years, we're still not great at that in retail.
Yeah, so one of the things that we are doing really good is that as a retailer, as a designer, when you work with a retailer, chances are that the customers are gonna try on that item and give you feedback. It's very slim, but with us, we know that 100% of the customer are gonna try on the item that we suggest them, and we're gonna get feedback immediately. So it's very end-to-end information from consumers.
Thank you very much. Neha?
So before I founded Obsess, I had been building web and mobile products for 10 years. And then I tried virtual reality for the first time. It was a year and a half ago at this point with the Oculus Dev Kit 2. And I was just completely blown away. If you haven't tried virtual reality personally yourself yet, I would highly recommend you to do it because it's something that you can't really understand until you actually experience it. So I, like many others, became convinced that virtual reality and augmented reality are going to be the next consumer platform after smartphones, and that in the future, all of our digital interactions, including shopping, will be using these new mediums. And there are two fundamental properties of virtual reality that really make it great for retail. One is that it's 360 degrees around you, so instead of a small rectangular screen, the digital experience that you can create can really be all around the user, and the user is inside of it, and they are immersed in it. And the second is that everything is 3D. So unlike your smartphones and your desktop, where we are trying to represent everything in 2D, virtual reality and augmented reality, like real life, are in 3D, where you can move through spaces in 3D, you can show products in 3D. So essentially, using those two properties, we are building experiences such as being able to visit stores virtually from your home, or being able to show life-size scale products and models in 3D. Or if you are, or showing products in contextual environments. So for example, if you're trying to sell a resort collection, you could take the user to a beautiful beach. So we believe that VR will be the predominant form of commerce for the product categories and brands where discovery is important or experience is important. So it's not for every product category. But where the experience is as important as the product and where discovery is important, this is going to be the way that the future generations are going to shop.
I think that's fantastic. If you think about that, again, another tip of the iceberg, a technology opportunity, virtual reality. In fact, we've been messing around in our own lab with the idea that, here's my question, when I need a product, everybody, everywhere you go, everything is listening, right, your device. So if I'm talking about how cold I am and I need a coat, why doesn't a virtual reality 3D coat store with only coats I like in my size pop up again in virtual reality right in front of me? So VR pop-up stores that are based on whatever you were talking about that already know your product preferences, why would I go to a real store or even a website anymore if virtual reality would create a store based on what I want right now right in front of me? These are the questions we got to solve, and the people that do are going to win big time, right? There'll be stores with crickets chirping because nobody showed up because a virtual reality 3D pop-up store created exactly what I needed when I needed. Or like you said, why would I buy clothing I hope that would fit if I could scan my body and have it made perfectly to me by devices? Really, really exciting time to be in retail. By the way, some people think these trends are scary. They're not scary, they're exciting. You know why? Because every time a new technology comes out, the playing field is leveled and there's a new opportunity for everybody to take the lead, even if you weren't in it before. I'd like you guys, we'll go back, where did we start? We'll start with you and we'll go back the other way for this one before we open it up a little bit. But I would like you to talk about how you see, I'd like you to each of you guys to dream a little bit. And you can dream around your company and your technology, but someday your company's successful and big, how has the industry changed? How are retailers and consumers behaving differently because of the space that you're in? I'd like to just hear your visions a little bit.
So I believe that the future of commerce is going to be 3D and immersive. So if you think about e-commerce user interfaces, right, like they haven't changed in 20 years since Amazon and eBay started. We're still using the same like grid format. You're just putting a database on a web page. You have lots of scrolling. You have filters and checkboxes. And that works great for specific types of products where you know exactly what you're looking for. But for a wide variety of products, that doesn't lead to discovery. And so the first wave of the internet was really about information, and that's what the current interfaces are about. The next wave of the internet is going to be about experiences, and consumers are going to expect experiences both in physical retail and in digital retail. And so we really kind of foresee a future where you are getting these experiential moments from brands at any given moment where they are personalized to you and you're able to see all products in 3D like you do in real life. You're able to move through stores, move through spaces, move through different kinds of experiences. You're in the center of a shoot, you're in the middle of a campaign, you're standing next to a celebrity in virtual reality. And that's going to be the expectation of the next generation of consumers.
Fantastic.
So for me, in clothing business, in the real world will be, if you go into a fitting room with 12 items, all those items are going to fit you. And if you order online 12 items, all those 12 items are going to fit you. So we can solve the problem of our return, because return rate is really high for e-commerce. So I think that, you know, collecting all this important information from customers at the beginning of the purchase and at the end of the purchase, what they didn't like versus what they like most, and try to avoid those don't versus more, and be able to deliver those items to them in 100% fit and style and sizes and categories, I think it's a win-win for e-commerce.
I think for us, it's about what's happening internally within organizations. There's been a lot of reorgs and shifts, and if you look at the marketing organizations, you know, over the last 5 years, that's just been dramatically different. And so with us, if we're empowering, you know, each individual within your organization with the power of a personalized data scientist or assistant, you know, imagine how much more efficiently your operation can run. And so, you know, when I think back to why we started this, it's not just like, oh, big data is a trend. It's like, when I think back to my days early on in my career, when I had a good idea, it was really cute or it was a great idea. When I had data to back that up, it was really empowering and it became a business opportunity. So for being the power of information, consumer insights, to individuals at the merchandise assistant level, to the fashion office, you know, where they are discovering ROI opportunities. Imagine as that rolls up and how bureaucratic organizations can shift to more of a meritocracy, and how you can really re-engage, you know, organizations and really, you know, find different ways to find talent and new ideas across different department silos.
Excellent.
So our vision is really to make testing physical products as easy to test as software. So if you think about tech companies out there like Facebook or Google, they are releasing thousands of versions of their product every single day. They're constantly shipping and testing and iterating. And we want to give that same capability to retail products. So our goal is just to eliminate physical samples entirely, make everything tested digitally, and enable retail companies to test thousands of different products to land on the variation that will be most successful for their individual customer base.
And kind of to tie what everyone else is saying, our goal is to make getting a custom product just as easy as it is to buy a regularly pre-made product online or in store. So it's about going into stores, having something that's perfectly fitting for you because you were body scanned or because we know certain measurements about you, very easy, like your height, which is what we're doing now with neckties. So you can come into the store, get something made for you, and walk away with it. It's about making customization and really granular fit so that it's not just this sort of fits, but this is made specifically for me.
So that's an interesting vision, if you guys think about that. One day we go into a store, and instead of racks of products hanging on the shelf, there's nothing but quietly humming 3D printers. They're making exactly what you want, how you want it, when you walk in. That's a pretty interesting vision versus the retail store of today. I want to turn the discussion now to customers a little bit. You know, we have this big sort of the elephant in the room, or this big back and forth struggle between privacy and one-on-one personalization. As a consumer, we're frustrated that you don't have exactly what we want. But as a retailer, the only way we can give you what we want is to learn as much about you as possible. And as soon as we do that, people read about data breaches and they feel like Big Brother is watching them. So there's a battle between, you should know exactly what I want when I walk into your store. And by the way, I don't want to give you any of my personal information. Let's talk about, from each of you, I'll go one more time to each of you, and then we're just going to open it up a little bit. How has your customer, and some of you are servicing retailers directly and some consumers, so whatever it is, talk about your customer. How has your customer changed in ways that if people don't react to, they will not be able to do business with those customers going forward? What are the biggest changes you see in your customer base and how you're dealing with them?
So for our customers, the ones that get what we're doing right away is anyone under 30. They come in, they see this machine, they say, I know my favorite colors. Like, I want to get this made for me. Why would I want to dress like someone else? Why would I want to go to a party wearing the same thing? So for us, we don't guess what you want, you tell us. And people are happy to tell you what they want when they can get a product made for them. So that's been easy for us.
Okay, but that was very interesting because you said the customer under 30. Mm-hmm. So we should all feel free to talk about that as well. We all know that the millennial generation customer is one we've never seen before. The first customer ever raised on technology and the first customer ever connected by social media. So they're the first customer ever that we can no longer sell. All we can do is help people buy. And that's subtle but really important. It's a generation of customers. If you tell them what to buy from you, they're turned off and they're gone. But if you say, I'd like to equip you to make the best possible buying decision, here's some information, that works. So it's a very different customer when you get to that generation there. How about you? How is your customer? And tell us how they've changed or are changing.
Yeah, absolutely. So I would say that our customers are primarily B2B, whether they're at an enterprise level or more direct-to-consumer startups. And we create chat platforms that their customers engage with. And so the number one thing that I would say is that customers are definitely willing to provide data and information about themselves as long as they're receiving something in return. So if you're just kind of letting out your information for anyone to take, that's not a very engaging experience. But if you're providing information so that your favorite brands or retailers can make products you love, or so that they can recommend personalized recommendations based on your individual tastes and preferences, people are willing to provide that data.
So that was a really important point. Don't ask people anything unless you're giving them something in return. But you know what? Tell them up front. If you were to provide me this information, I could blank. I could have the product exactly the way you want it before you even get to the store. Tell them what the benefit is so that they have some reason to share information with you. Really important point. Thank you.
So I think for us, the consumer information we're looking at is at scale and it's anonymized, and so that's, you know, obviously there's important rules that you have to follow. As far as retailers, their information is private and we don't share that. I would say what is different though is in the beginning, people didn't want to, they wanted to keep their best practices to themselves and really have it as a competitive edge, but now there's a lot more. And I mean, this is why everyone's here today, right? There's a lot more interest in what are some of the best practices, being able to learn from each other and areas, to innovate and what are the people doing? And so we're seeing a lot more collaboration and interest around processes and ideas.
Excellent, thank you, Monica.
So my business is also to end consumers. So it comes down to a collaboration of what the customer wants and what we can offer them. And for us, we have a very comprehensive quiz. And it's surprisingly, customers are really willing to give us a lot of information because they do want the help. They want the upside of it. So if you are providing an upside, then I think they're not going to be hesitant of giving the information. So it's help me help you situation.
Excellent. Yeah?
So our customers are going to be brands and retailers that will create VR experiences for their customers. In terms of the end users, VR is a very new technology. 2016 was sort of year zero when the consumer devices came out, but the early customer base is definitely the younger customer base, like for most of us. For the Samsung Gear VR, which is a mobile device, it was most of it was sold to 21 to 35-year-olds. And this is the generation that's really adopting new technology at a faster pace than ever before. So even if some of us can't imagine that we will be sitting in our headset at some point doing most of our activities, the newer generation is doing that. And for example, in China, Macy's launched a virtual store for Singles Day where they actually, Macy's doesn't have a physical store in China. They don't have an e-commerce site. So they launched in the biggest market in the world with a virtual store, and 8 million people tried it within 10 days of launch. So that's kind of the customer side. On the data side, VR, again, is still very new, but it's going to give us more data than is possible through any other medium because you can essentially track where the user is looking at any given point. So if you're in an experience or a store, you can track the entire time what the user is looking at, what they're gazing at, how much time they're spending looking at each product. So this will still be an open question of how we deal with that data and what the privacy implications are, but the potential for the amount of data and insights and analytics that we'll be able to collect with VR and AR will be much more than possible today.
So think about what she said. They opened a virtual store and 8 million people went there already without any bricks or mortar and a big market like China. That is amazing. I was in Japan recently and there was a concert And I said, what's going on there? There was almost 15,000 people. They said, come in and look. The pop star, you can Google this, the Japanese pop star who was performing to 15,000 live people is not real. She is holographic, and she holds concerts all over, and she draws 15,000 people, and she's not real. She's a glowing hologram that sings, and it's unbelievable. The next generation of customer has a different expectation and is willing to accept things that other customers won't. We just have a few minutes left. And what I'd like to do, and I'll just leave this open, just raise your hand. I would like to hear a couple of questions from you guys. What scares you most in retail? What are you most worried about that we should worry about? Or what excites you most in retail, in the future of retail? What's on your mind when you guys go to sleep at night? What are you worried about or what are you excited about? Anybody want to answer either of those? Just raise your hand, just jump in. I would just love to hear you guys' thoughts on what's exciting and what's scary.
Sure, I mean, we're really, even though most of our business is e-commerce, we're really excited about retail. Creating such a personal connection with products that we're making and the consumers are co-creating really is a really powerful experience. Having that consumer understand not just like where their products are made, but why they were made. That connection between messaging them when their product is being made, communicating as it goes through the whole life cycle of that product is really exciting. So we have so many great connections to consumers. When we bring the machine in, they get to see it, and then they give us feedback right away. So we knew when we first opened our first pop-up last year, the consumers, they came in, they were like, these ties are really great, scarves are great, but can you make socks? And so we knew that that was going to be the next custom product that we could make. So that consumer interaction is invaluable. And even as you know things move more online, we'll still have retail because consumers want to touch and feel the products and they want to have an interesting experience.
But think about the trend there that she just highlighted. The shift of power is going from retailer to consumer. It's been going. But think about this. What was the retail process? I go to your retail store, online or offline, to try to find the thing I want. I have to go rack to rack or screen to screen, hope you have it. The future of retail is, I'm not going to shop at all. I'm going to tell you I want exactly this, and whoever can provide it fastest and cheapest and highest quality is going to get my business. The consumer is going to drive retail as it's already happening, not the retailer saying, here's what I have, hope you want to buy something. We're going to tell you, this is what I want, sell me that. Who else?
What's really exciting about retail today, whether you're an entrepreneur or an investor in this space, is that you know overall each individual market is not growing that much, but the market shifts are happening between companies are happening so fast. There are companies that direct-to-consumer companies I know that are going to $0 to $100 million within like a couple of years, and it's really exciting. And I think the point you brought up around earlier is so true. Right now, all these concepts here feel a little radical. Eventually, like it could be the new norm in retail. But anytime there's a new phase or innovation, it really does level the playing field. So I think it's a super exciting time for brands and retailers to reinvent themselves in so many different ways.
Excellent.
Yeah, I'm very excited about how we're using technology to amplify and to be able to run our businesses better as the e-commerce, because 10 years ago, there was no way for us to have a better way of cost per acquisition and lifetime value. And now we have all this information in terms of like everything is just so personalized. Like consumers are changing. They are expecting a better delivery. They're expecting a better experience. They're expecting a personalized service. So I'm very excited about all this technology that enable us to do this.
Do you want to add? Please.
Yeah. So I'm excited and scared about the flip sides of the same thing, which is that all the stuff that we have talked about, having all this data and giving consumers exactly what they want when they want it, which is great. But at the same time, I'm scared that that's going to make everyone produce the same thing. So you see this in media where all the websites are writing the same stories because you know that that's going to get the highest clicks. And you see that in fashion where a lot of designers and brands are making the same thing because the data is telling them that this is what is trending this season, and now all we see is that. And so I think the creativity is actually what's going to be more important in the future, because the analytical and data insights will become universally accessible through technology and platforms like what a lot of us are making. And then what's going to become important is that everyone has the same data, but then how are you going to be creative with that data? Because the data can get you to like a local optimization, like a local maxima, but it can't give you new ideas. Like it can't tell you like what's the next thing to make. And so I feel like brands need to continue focusing on that while, you know, still balancing, like, taking in analytical insights.
Okay, want to add anything?
Yeah, I'd love to. So I think what really excites me is just the opening up of the variety of shopping experiences for the consumer. So whether it's through VR or whether it's through voice or whether it's through chat, it just opens up a whole new vehicle for engaging with consumers. So to focus on chat, with Facebook Messenger, for example, this is where people are spending their time. This is where they're messaging with friends. And it also provides this wealth of information for retailers and brands. So you can see a person's profile picture, where they live, where they work. And from there, you can create a really personalized set of recommendations for that person, which isn't, right now, it's not possible in brick and mortar or even through an e-commerce experience.
Excellent. Can we have the slides back? I'm going to wrap up now to respect your time. I want to remind you again, Twitter handles are on here. We would love you to tweet about what you learned, what you like, or what you didn't like. That's the only way that all of us grow. We need to hear your comments. The event itself is NRF17. That's the Twitter handle. We are Radical Startups and Radical Retail. I also want to remind you before we go that we really need your feedback, so please do that as well. To give feedback so that NRF can continue to make sure we're giving you good content. We need to know if we did a good job for you today, and if not, how we can do better. And can we get the spots off and the house lights off up for real quick? We want to turn those spotlights off if you can. Don't move, just for 1 second. You guys stand up. We're going to do a really quick selfie with you guys. I'm part of a network of startups in 160 countries who are trying to disrupt industries everywhere, and we want to show them that you guys care. The startups are relevant, innovative, and that you're listening. So come here and face this way. I'll do this quick. And if everybody can just wave, we just want to show everybody that you care, that startups matter. All right. Thank you all for coming. We'll stay up here.